Okay.
So I guess I'll start. So welcome back. I'll talk to you about, tell you a little bit about what we are doing currently in the lab. There's a huge number of things that you do, that we do, but something that's been really interesting just over the last 2 or 3 months is something I will tell you about. It's a very short lecture on specific one thing. The question that you're wondering about is, what do we understand by membrane border? All of you know that all cells have plasma membranes. They're hugely important, not just as a cover for the rest of the stuff that is intracellular, but also this theater of action for much of what the cell does. Lots of proteins are there, which are dynamic. There are a lot of receptors, which, you know, proteins which are receptors, proteins which are transporters, a huge number of things. And of course, there is the membrane itself is not a very homogeneous entity. It has different components in it. Some of the components are localized on the membrane at some places. Some so local areas have higher concentration of some components, some lower, etc. And these separations in different places also is important. There are these raft things that Jitu Mehr, who runs this course, has done a lot on. And it's important for signaling and many other things. So characterizing a plasma membrane, which is nothing but a bilayer of lipids. Lipid is nothing but it has a head group and two tails, typically two tails. There are lipids with more or less than two, but typically a two-tailed lipid. And the head group is typically polar, so they're polar lipids. So they face water, and the tails actually form the interface between the two layers and gives the thickness. And you have a 4-nanometer object that can cover the cell. It's a sheet. Now, this is not too stiff and not too loose. If it's too loose, then things will go through it, water and other things. So it's a barrier. So it has to be stiff enough that it doesn't let through things that the cell doesn't want to come in or to go out. But it has to be loose enough so that proteins which are dynamic, some pores that need to open, okay, some transport that needs some conformational change of the proteins can happen in this layer. So it's just at the optimal, kind of properties, neither too well packed, nor too loosely packed. So there's this concept of membrane order. How ordered are my lipid molecules, which can diffuse about in the membrane? And in some cases, the order can change, and it has physiological consequences. Till very recently, at least I used to think, okay, membrane order is membrane order. You know, you can think of lipids as ordered or disordered, and the local region can be ordered or disordered. But I never thought deeply about what you actually mean by membrane order. So people actually, hold on. People actually measure membrane order, and a lot of confocal microscopy is done on dyes that will go into the membrane and give you membrane order, the local order of the membrane. Okay, so this is a you can see a lipid bilayer, local part. These are the tails I was talking about. These are the head groups. And you can see this is a disordered region. The tails are sort of flopping about. And this is a more ordered region. Okay. So there are molecules that can be put in, and you can look at it, the dye molecules. And you can measure membrane order, order by spectral shift of some dyes. So there are some dyes which are lipophilic. That means they will go and sit inside the membrane. They go to different depths, there are debates about that, but when they find an environment that has very little disorder, so is mostly ordered, then there is very little water ingress into them. And this kind of polarity that they sense, and they give one kind of emission spectrum. same molecule, but in a disordered region of the membrane where the water dynamics, water ingress is a little more, occasionally water molecule does come in, we'll have a more polar environment and we'll give a spectrum which is different from the same molecule sitting in an ordered region. So if you have a spectrally sensitive detector, that's something I didn't get time to talk about in confocal. Not only you can put a filter for the right fluorescence, these days you actually have a bunch of channels, 32 for example, which will take different parts of the color. So you can have a spectrum built up of molecules, which will have a blue spectrum, spectrum built up of molecules, which have green spectrum, and taking the ratio or knowing the color anywhere. So of course, nowhere is perfectly green and nowhere is perfectly blue. This region, it will go from one side to the other. But taking that spectral shift from, let's say, red to green to blue, you know how ordered the membrane is. Okay, there's a very nice and cheap dye is Nile Red, which is used, or some variants of Nile Red. But people want to do much more quantitative work. They typically use something called Laudan, which is a lipid tail, and a group that actually does the fluorescence. And that also senses the local order or local disorder. And you calculate something called the generalized polarization value from the spectrum. It's nothing but some kind of an arithmetic between the intensity of the spectrum at one place and the intensity of the spectrum at another place. A minus B divided by A plus B. Oh, fair enough. However, both are used and have been used for decades to show in biologically very important experiments that the membrane is getting more disordered or less disordered. So it's a very accepted reporter for membrane order. Okay? But it's measuring something. You know, you're not actually looking at, this is important, the tail and where they are, or heads and how disturbed the heads are. You're just looking at some sort of thing that the Laudan feels. Is that what we, is that the only thing we can do to measure membrane order? Are there other measures, and do different measures agree? That's the whole point of this talk. So we decided to measure it in a different way, which is squish it or try to puncture it. So you come out with a, come down with an AFM tip, atomic force microscope tip, and try to puncture the membrane. Okay, you push and push and push. It, as it comes from the water, it first feels some resistance here. So you can see that in this curve, it feels some resistance and it sort of the force, the vertical deflection goes up, the force goes up until there's a point where it quickly again breaks through. The membrane cannot sustain anymore. And depending on the tip radius and the force, it gives way. And then you get a little little shift, little kink in this curve, and then it comes and hits the bottom surface because you're lowering the AFM probe, it goes up again. So where this breakthrough happens can be very quantitatively determined. This is in force in nanonewtons, you see 10 to the minus 9. So a few nanonewtons, typical biological membrane will break. That depends on the composition itself. So we decided that that's also a good measure of membrane order, because we would think that where membrane is more disordered, it will be softer and it will be easier to make a pore in or to break it apart. And where the membrane is more ordered, it will be harder. Turned out to be true. And we have biphasic membranes that I can artificially built. There are hard regions and soft regions, and that are known because there is a composition by which you see the harder regions actually are more ordered because they stand up. The depth of the membrane changes as you go from one place to the other. And it's all well known, and we go and push along the things which are more ordered, and we find higher force than things which are disordered. So there's a, at least another way of measuring membrane order. What else? Well, I said when you look at the tail groups, you don't actually see them. You are probing them with some fluorophore and some sort of average property you are measuring. But there is a technique, it's called solid state NMR, which can actually probe at least the atoms of the lipid tails atom by atom, carbon by carbon, how much movement they are having, how disordered they are. So they can give you the disorder and carbon atom number one from top of the chain to the bottom of the chain, let's say carbon number, atom number 18 or 16, or depending on the lipid what you have. Okay, this is called magic angle spinning or mass, this thing, MAS. And it is possible to look at that. And this is the most accurate measure of membrane order you can find, except it can only look at some sort of some lipids, and it can only look at the lipid tail. So what you do is you deuterate one chain and don't deuterate another. I won't get to the technique. And you can look at it atom by atom, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, et cetera, et cetera. I go down the chain. This is the head group, the polar head group. This is the lipid tail. And I have deuterated it, and this is what you have. And you can, as I said, look at disorder here. So this is yet another measure of order, at least of this region. Now, if we think that when I talk about membrane order or membrane disorder, every probe should report the same thing, right? That a spectroscopic probe such as Nilet or Claude and GP value will move in a certain way if the membrane is becoming more ordered or more disordered. In a similar way, my force, so if it's becoming more disordered, the GP value would be lower, and in night red, it'll shift to redder wavelengths. My AFM should report lower force, and my NMR should report higher dynamics in this. Does that happen is the question we have been asked. If it happens, everything is hunky-dory. You can choose your probe, and depending on what works for you, you can report it, and you can interpret it as membrane order. If it doesn't agree, then I would say you don't know what you're talking about. Okay? Because, okay, let's come to it. So we found out very recently, the work that preceded this, that what I'm talking about, it came out in Chemistry, a European journal, just less than a week ago, I think, that a small molecule called serotonin, serotonin is a neurotransmitter, actually changes membrane mechanical properties. And this itself was very interesting to us. It turns out that serotonin, of course, has its own receptor, and it works through the receptor. But even if you block all the receptors, it still has some effect on the cell. Turns out it is because it can change membrane order, and that can affect all kinds of cell responses. But this is not what I'm going to talk about. I'm just saying serotonin is a molecule that can change membrane order. So you use this as an agent for changing order, and looked at those probes and asked, do they all tell the same story? Well, here is one bilayer. So lipid bilayers are made for AFM, different compositions you can make. I call this PPC111. This POPC, POPG cholesterol, 1:1:1 molar ratio. So convenient. PPC11. That's a standard bilayer. It's a negatively charged. Now, so if you do AFM imaging, you find something like this. But if you then press in and measure the force, okay, without serotonin, you see there is a force which is about 2.5 nanometers. Okay, there's a distribution because we measured it in many, 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 many places. And of course, there's real life and you have a distribution. They are nicely peaked around 2.5 newton. With serotonin, this force goes down drastically, not just 10%, 20%, 30%. It goes from 2.5 to something like 1.1, 1.2. More than a factor. And it shows here 2.5 to 1.2 or 1.2. So this we interpreted as disorder. Membrane is becoming more disordered in presence of serotonin. However, that's not what we expected before we started those experiments. Because serotonin by molecular dynamics simulation. So these are all new results that people are coming up with, because serotonin was not known to interact with membranes. They sit in the amongst the head group. So I thought it'll be packing would be better. But anyway, it makes it more disorder. So it decreases the stiffness. Let's be very careful about words. I won't call it disorder. I'll say it decreases the stiffness. That much I'm sure. Measure the force, it decreases the stiffness. We went to find out what will happen atom by atom. Where is this disorder? And these are plots from the solid-state NMR studies. I told you there is some measure called the order parameter. So higher the order parameter, more ordered that thing is. And these are the carbon numbers carbon number 2, carbon number 3, carbon number 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, to the 16. In any case, the blue curve, the red curve is something that you have without serotonin, 0 mole percent, sorry, black curve, 0 mole percent. So the black curve is something. In any case, as you go down into the center of the lipid bilayer, the disorder increases because it's more space, more disorder there. But when you put serotonin, we see the disorder increases, not drastically, but at least disorder increases quite measurably, even at C2 and all the way up to C12 or so. After that, it's hard to measure because anyway, it's very disordered. So that's fine. And this happens at 25 and 37 and all of that. And we are very happy. Yes, we have measured something that disorder increases as serotonin goes in, both by AFM4 tells the same story as the NMR, which is sort of a very strong quantitative measure. So forget about these headings. These are very new results. So I just got those and threw some slides in because I thought I'll talk about something new today. All hell broke loose when we wanted to do Nile red or Lauder. Okay? On the left is the Nile red spectrum, and black is without the serotonin, which is called 5-HT also. And to tell you that Nile red spectrum should shift towards bluer wavelengths if it's more ordered. It should shift towards the redder wavelengths if it's more disordered. And Nile red spectrum clearly moves to the bluer things, indicating it is more ordered. These are the same membranes which have become softer, easier to make pores in, and also my NMR measurement shows that the tails are more disordered. We went to another type of membrane where we have a biphasic membrane. So in the AFM image, you can clearly see disordered regions and ordered regions. Okay, and you can measure the same thing, Nile red, and you'll see that as you go from disordered region without 5-HT and disordered region with 5-HT, the solid lines, then the disordered region doesn't change much. But so in DEC 221, disordered and ordered region, they don't change very much. So in PPC 111, there's a clear indication that it changes and it becomes more ordered. In DEC 221, nothing changes. Yet in both of these, if we do AFM, we find that both gets easier to make to break through. So they become softer. There's the Laudan generalized polarization. So people who want to do more quantitative biological work, and they use this, typically done in a multiphoton microscope. And something that you can also see in generalized polarization images of this DEC 221. As I said, you have regions which are ordered, regions which are disordered. So bright regions means higher order, darker regions is lower order. If you put Laudan in it, and this is without serotonin, and this is 5 millimolar serotonin. You do it in the PPC 111, you see changes, and this you see changes. But the changes that you see, the change upon using serotonin is in the positive direction. That is, the delta GP actually shows the membrane is getting more ordered. Both the ordered regions, which is these regions, and the disordered regions, which are these dark regions, they both get more ordered. Same for PPC 111, that Laudan actually shows that the membrane gets more order. So these are completely opposite. And the whole message of this talk is that if you're doing biology and trying to probe membrane order, you better know what you're talking about. It is not the same thing as saying if you're thinking about a pore opening, it may actually be telling you the opposite story. So here's a summary of what it has done. I've used 5-HT just as an agent. AFM from the same membrane shows the membrane gets more disordered. NMR confirms those results. Yet Nile red and Laudan both show that the membrane gets more ordered. So this is the message I wanted to give you. I thought I'll have to fit it in within the 1 hour. So I had a 10-minute kind of presentation. I realize now that I had more time, but that's okay. So I have told you what I wanted to tell you. And the people who have done this work is Shimli. And most of the work that I've shown today is by Ankur. Okay, Shimli Ankur. And there's some of the work is also done by Diana. So Ankur is this guy. Okay, has done most of this work, Shimli and Diana. And of course, there are other people in my group, a small group. And they're very hardworking guys. And they're the guys who actually do all these works. And some of this actually was even Ankur's idea to come up with comparisons proper, etc. So hats off to Ankur. He has pointed out ultimately to a very, very strong statement, pointed out a very strong flaw in many biological literature, which assumes that if the Lorden GP value or the Nile rate goes one way, the whole of the membrane is behaving that way. Right now, what we are thinking and doing experiments on is try to put probes at different depths of the thing. So what do I think about it? I don't know yet. It's very new results. As you squish something, you get an average over the whole membrane. But a Lorden or a Nile red is locally going to some depth, not everywhere. It's pretty much known where do they go. They do go. And the environment is changing one way there, but the whole average environment is changing in a different way in different places. So when you squish it, it gives way. You get it's more disordered. And when you just put Lorden or Nile red, you find it's more ordered. And unfortunately, NMR cannot look through order throughout the lipid membrane. But if you're looking at the tail group, that's probably the best way to look at it. So it has its own limitation. It needs very high concentration of agents to measure any changes. But it shows that things actually are disordered in the tail. Okay. So that's all I'll say. And thank you very much. And these are the people who have helped us do it. Danielle and Gilbert, Vidita and Santhil are part of that thing, the paper that came out a week ago, and financial support comes from BBT and TIMR. Thank you very much. Any questions?